All right, now we actually know enough to talk about how FFT convolve from SciPy is implemented. So this is a fast way of doing convolution. If we follow the definition naively, then we actually end up having to do a nested loop because we have to compute this sum for every single sample in the output signal. And that's very slow. That's a quadratic algorithm. And that doesn't scale well at all. So that actually wouldn't. So I had this example with Jesse's Girl and the JFK Tunnel, if you remember that. Jesse's Girl and the JFK Tunnel. So there's my impulse response. And if I try to do this with NumPy's convolution, which actually implements it the slow way, if I try to say y is equal to mp dot convolve, mp dot convolve, it should be, okay, xh. Okay, this is not gonna be good. I'm gonna be waiting for a long time. So let me interrupt that. If instead I say FFT convolve XH, this is going to go very quickly. And we can do some cool stuff. Boom, it's done. Now I hear. So I hear like this, as if it were played in this environment. So that's cool. And it went like boom. Okay. So one thing I want to look at is, okay, let me say that N is the length of the first signal, and then I'll say that M is the length of H. Well, what is the length of, so let me print this, I'll say N equals M, M equals M, and then what is the length of the impulse response? So that is length of Y. So can we see a pattern? Well, what I notice is, if I look carefully, actually this is, I'll show you, this is actually M plus N minus 1. Boom, see those two numbers are the same. The reason is, if we go back and look at the convolution, we have to wait for the echoes to die out. So if this, okay, this thing here is, looks like it's about 170 samples. This original thing is 200. That means I need to go up to around 200 plus 170. So up to about there. And that's because, you know, I need to make room for all the echoes to happen. So anyway, you can just remember, I mean, that's the intuition, but you can just remember that the length of the convolution is the sum of the lengths of the individual signals minus one. But the proof I did a moment ago, when I proved that I had this multiplication property, relied on the fact that they were both length n. So that seems unfortunate. That doesn't seem like it's going to quite work. In other words, I might not be able to, somehow what I want to do is to take the Fourier transform, which I can do quickly with the fast Fourier transform. I want to be able to take the Fourier transform, do the multiplication, and then do the inverse Fourier transform to go back. But I can't quite do that because I need these two things to be the same length. So what I have to do is something called zero padding. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to make two signals that are long enough of all zeros, and I'm just going to put each one of these as in the beginning. Okay. So what I'll say is, I guess I'll say xz is equal to mp.zeros. M plus N minus 1. And I'll say XZ from 0 to M is X. Now I'll say HZ, so the impulse response zero padded is going to be NP dot 0 is M plus N minus 1. And I'll say HZ from 0 to N is H. Okay, so this is called zero padding. Before I do anything else, I want to show you that this, let's see, it's complaining here. What is it complaining about? Oh, sorry, N was the length of H, X, and M was the length of H. Okay, there we go. Before I go too much further, I just want to show you really quickly that this doesn't really affect the Fourier transform that much, which is kind of surprising. So if I say PLT dot Well, it's really like applying a window function, actually. So it ends up doing a convolution in the frequency domain, but it's actually an interpolation. Okay, let me show you what I mean. So if I say plt.plot mp.apps mp.fft of x, so I plot that in one place, and then right below it, I'll plot the Fourier transform of the zero padded version. So here is x, here is zero padded x, and let's just see what they look like. Oops, mp.fft.fft. Okay. So they don't really like look that different, do they? Hang on, let's see. So they don't really look that different. Right? But what I notice is that zero padded X actually has more frequency bins than X. The difference is actually a little more stark in H, because H is a lot smaller than X, so we're going to have mostly zeros in H. Let's just look at this. Okay, so I see in this one I have about 100,000 samples, and this one I have about over 1,000,000. But you see, they look the same. If I zoom in a little bit on the one down here, what I'll see is, so I guess I'll zoom in maybe to 200,000 down there. Actually, I need to zoom in a little more to see this. So, and even more. Even more, even more, even more. So 10,000, maybe I'll zoom in to just 200 to see so I can really look. Okay, so what this does, zero padding leads to interpolation. What it means is the whole thing is going to look the same. I'm just going to fill in some gaps in between. So anyway, the whole point of all this is zero padding doesn't actually change the frequency response. It just gives you more frequency bins. Since you're not adding any information, those frequency bins are just interpolated from the frequency bins around them. And you can also think of it as convolving with you know, the Fourier transform of rect. Okay, fine. But what I'm really trying to do is create two signals that have the same length, so I can actually take the DFT and multiply them together. That's really what I'm trying to do with zero padding. So I've got them. So now I can say, maybe I'll just say capital X is equal to mp.fft.fft of xz. So I'll use the zero padded version. Then capital H is equal to mp.fft of fft of hz. And so then I'm just going to say y is equal to x times h. So I'm using the fact that convolution is multiplication in the frequency domain. And I can do this because these are now the same length because I've zero padded them. And now let me go back to the time domain. I'll say y is equal to mp.fft.iFft of big Y. So perform the inverse DFT to go back to the time domain. So let's listen. Okay, so see, it's doing it. It didn't take too long. And remember, okay, it's complaining. It's like, okay, this isn't actually a real signal, but it is, just because of numerical precision. Let's do that. Okay. And then eventually, because I've zero padded it, well, no, actually, this is perfect. I want to tell her that I love her, but the point is brother. Okay, and then it dies out. So that's, look, we just did it. Amazingly, we did a convolution without actually doing this. So all I did was zero pad things so that they lined up. I could take the Fourier transform and then brought them back. Okay, but there's just one little thing. There's one little implementation detail that's kind of important, which I'll have you work out in the last exercise in this module. The fast Fourier transform algorithm is a version of what's known, or an instance of what's known as the divide and conquer algorithm. It repeatedly halves the signal that it's processing until it gets down to a small enough size in these little chunks. Because it halves, it actually requires the input to be a power of 2 in length. So actually, when you zero pad, you actually need to zero pad up to the nearest power of 2. And then when you're done, you can just cut it down. Like, if I include extra zeros, it's not really a problem. So if I could do that, I can just say, like, let's pretend that M was actually the same as N. I'm going to zero pad both of these a lot more than I needed to, but I'll still get the convolution I was looking for. It just means that, let's see, what is it complaining about here? But I thought these were the same. HC, M is equal to N. Anyway. No, I want to get this to work. Hang on. HC is equal to NP to zeros. Yeah, I'll just make this 2 times N minus 1. Oh, I know what's happening. Okay. No, I did something silly. I should just say H from 0 to length of H is H. Okay, fine. So I've zero pad a lot more than I needed to. But it just means that when I go to do this, I hate it when it does this. It's making it look like it's way longer than it should be. Okay, now it's a minute. It just means that once it dies out, there's going to be silence because I zero padded them more than I needed to. But you could just cut out that silence. You know, I feel so. Okay. So that's what you actually do in practice. All right, so get to it, and that's it.